see that if your body continues to be weak, it doesn't matter how strong a spirit you have, or how strong or healthy a mind and emotions you may have. If your body is weak, then the life cannot flow out to the outside world. And actually what happens is, it dams up inside you. And you remember, the natural life of our spirit is expressed in, the last few psalms in the book of Psalms, if you like to look at it. Any of those psalms at the very end of the book really express the normal state of our spirits, anywhere from 144 to 150. But if you look at 144, this is the normal activity of our spirits when they're filled with the Holy Spirit. In other words, the Holy Spirit is like a fountain in the earth here, and it's continually rising up to God with this kind of attitude. Blessed be the Lord, my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle, my rock and my fortress, my stronghold and my deliverer, my shield and he in whom I take refuge. 145. I will extol thee, my God and King, and bless thy name forever and ever. Every day I will bless thee and praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have being. Now that's the normal attitude of our spirits. Now if your body is racked with sickness, do you see that it will block the outflow of your spirit up to God? And you've noticed that with a cold even. A cold is often enough to block your living, exultant spirit inside you so that it cannot rise up to God, and it certainly can't go out to other people. You've noticed with a cold, it kind of closes you in from other people. And any sickness kind of closes you in and blocks your spirit off. Now that's why, you see, it's so vital for our bodies to experience the wholeness that our spirits experience and that our souls experience. And that's why over the next few Sundays, I'd like to talk just about sickness. Because sickness is something that we're very conscious of in our everyday lives. And it's very important for us to know what our attitude to sickness should be and how we should use sickness and then how God can heal sickness. But you can see that if we don't move into this realm, brothers and sisters, then we'll always be crippled children of God with maybe spirits that are filled with His Holy Spirit and maybe minds that are renewed and emotions that are balanced, but with weak, tired, sick bodies that continually bear in on our spirits, press our spirits down, and repress our spirits, and make us in every way appear to the world, really, as unregenerate people. Now, that's what Jesus meant, you remember, when he referred to the disciples in Matthew 26 and verse 41. It really didn't matter what the desire of their spirit was, because the old body held them back from doing what he had asked them to do. And so it is with us. If our bodies are not made whole as he wants them to be, then repeatedly we'll find ourselves in the position of the disciples there in Matthew 26 and 41. You remember in the Garden of Gethsemane. Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And it wasn't the old self that Jesus meant was weak there. It was the body. The old body couldn't keep awake any longer. And if our bodies don't share the strength of Jesus, then we'll find ourselves often in that position. And I put it to you, you know, have you not done that? Have you not often found that there was a real desire in you to do something for God or to spend time in prayer, and yet the old body wouldn't respond? And it seemed as if you had a supernatural spirit, but you had only an old natural body that wouldn't rise to it. Now that's why it's vital, you can see, to have a body that fits your spirit and matches really what he wants you to do. Now, when we're talking about this business of sickness the next two or three Sundays, will you really look to Jesus to break the bread for you? Now, will you do that? Don't look to me, you see. Don't do that, loved ones. Don't look to preachers or teachers to break the bread for you. I'll say what Jesus guides me to say, but you see, you must ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, will you explain this to me in a way that I will understand? Otherwise, brothers and sisters, you'll go off on all kinds of wild ideas, you know. And you see, it'll take us two or three Sundays to deal with the whole business of sickness, and so we'll only talk about part of it tonight. So it's vital for you to look to the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to receive? Now, the reason I say this is 2 Timothy, if you like to look at it. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verses 6 and 7. It is really relevant to this kind of teaching, you know, about the deeper life. 2 Timothy and chapter 3 and verses 6 through 7. Paul isn't really against women's lib here. He's talking about those men among us who do the same thing. But he just, in this situation, it was women that were involved. 2 Timothy 3 and 6. For among them are those who make their way into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and swayed by various impulses. And then verse 7, who will listen to anybody and can never arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Now, that's why I say it, look to the Holy Spirit, you know. Don't run away home tonight and take a whole lot of things that I share and then just, without any question, accept them all. And then take something else that somebody else says, pile them on top. And one moment you'll be way over in this direction with healing, and another moment you'll be way over in this direction, and then you'll be down the middle for a while until you hear somebody else's tape on healing. Now, loved ones, don't do that. Look to the Holy Spirit tonight and say, Holy Spirit, I don't want to be a person like that, swayed to and fro by anybody who comes with any gospel. I want your word for me. And you can see each of us are at different stages, brothers and sisters. Each of us are at different stages in regard to our bodies tonight. And only the Holy Spirit can minister to you what will be life for you, you see. So that's important, you know. Otherwise, we get into all kinds of extremes. Now, maybe it would be good to look at what Jesus' attitude to sickness was. Now, let's look at it first in Romans 8 and verse 2. And you can see there the general teaching of the Bible about sickness. Romans 8 and verse 2. It's page 982 in that RSV. Romans 8 and 2. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. Now, the Bible links sin and death as two results of the fall of mankind. Death is the ultimate consequence of sickness. So really, the Bible links sin and death, or sin and sickness together. In fact, God implies that there was no death until men rebelled against God. Now, you can see that in Genesis 3 and verse 19 there. Genesis 3 and 19. And you remember God is speaking to Adam and telling him the consequences of this fall. Genesis 3 and 19. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you are taken, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And death was a result that followed upon man rebelling against God. In other words, sin and sickness are twin results of the fall. And God and Jesus look upon them as that. They don't look upon sickness as a natural thing. They look upon sickness and death as something that is not God's perfect will for us. And they tie them both up together, sin and death, sin and sickness. Now, Jesus came with a message for both of those. He came to to completely recapitulate our lives and completely reverse the effects of the fall. And so he came not only preaching forgiveness of sin, but he came preaching healing of sickness. Now, you can see it there in the first day that's recounted of his ministry in Matthew 4. The very first day of his ministry includes the emphasis on these two things. He came not only to forgive sins, but he came to heal sickness. And Matthew 4 and verse 17 there. From that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And that was his dealing with sin and forgiveness of sins. And then in verse 23 of that chapter, "And he went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every infirmity among the people." And Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom and healed every infirmity and every disease. So Jesus came both forgiving sins and healing sicknesses. And he regarded both, you know, as equally important parts of his ministry. And when he was sending out, you remember, the apostles, he gave them the same commission. You have it there. It's in Luke 9 and verses 1 and 2. Luke 9 and verses 1 and 2. When you remember, he sent out the 70. Luke 9 and verse 1. "And he called the 12 together, the 12, and gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to preach the kingdom of God and to heal." And you can't get away from it, no one. As you go right through the Bible, you find that God looks upon sin and sickness as both enemies of his in people's lives, and as both of them results of the fall of mankind. And these are both mentioned, you know, in that famous chapter, Isaiah 53, that talks about Jesus' death and the effects of his death. If you look at it, Isaiah 53 and verses 4 and 5. "Surely he has borne our griefs." And you see X, the footnote X in the RSV, and you look down to the bottom, "or sicknesses." And the Hebrew word is actually sicknesses. "Surely he has borne our sicknesses and carried our sorrows." And the footnote Y, you see, goes down to the word pains. And the Hebrew is pains. "Surely he has borne our sicknesses and carried our pains." And then in verse 5, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole. And with his stripes we are healed." And that's continually the emphasis in the Bible. That Jesus' death did something not only for our sins, but did something for our sicknesses. And Jesus came not only to forgive us our sins, but to heal our bodies and to heal sickness. And you find it, you know, in Psalm 103, you remember, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases." So, brothers and sisters, it's very hard for us to split sickness from sin, you see. It's very hard for us to say Jesus emphasized only forgiveness of sins. It's just very difficult to read anything about the gospel or anything about the description of our fall from God's fellowship and not to find sin and sickness linked together, and that Jesus really dealt with both. Sometimes he healed first. That's right. Sometimes he healed first, and sometimes he forgave people their sins first. I think this was really because the Jews at that time found it easier to believe for healing. That's strange. They found it easier to believe that Jesus was healing diseases than that he was forgiving sins. And so Jesus therefore dealt with sickness, you see. He dealt with people where they were. If they respected his power and healing, then he healed first. And so you see that, you know, in various situations. Matthew 9 and verse 5, you remember, was one of them, where obviously Jesus himself would have been inclined to forgive the man his sins. But then he saw the attitude of the Jews, and He, in that case, did the thing that they would find it easier to recognize, Matthew 9 and verse 5. For which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise and walk? And then verse 6, you see, but that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. He then said to the paralytic, rise, take up your bed and go home. And he rose and went home. When the crowd saw it, they were afraid, and they glorified God who had given such authority to men. And Jesus healed the man in that case because they were readier to believe in healing and the power to heal. And then once they believed that, then he felt they would begin to move on and see, well, if he can heal sickness, then maybe what he says about the forgiveness of sins is true. Now, in our day, it's the other way around. We find it easier in our churches to emphasize, oh yeah, Jesus can forgive your sins, but we find it difficult to believe that he can heal our sicknesses. And so Jesus has to deal with us in a different way. And yet it's important, you see, to see in Luke 5:24 that really it's both that Jesus wants done. Luke 5 and 24 and verse 20. Luke 5 and 24. But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, rise, take up your bed and go home. But then in verse 20, you see, and when he saw their faith, he said, man, your sins are forgiven you. And it's Jesus' will that both things should take place. Now, that isn't our attitude, you know. So often our attitude is, sin we can see belongs to the spiritual realm and is evil. But we feel sickness is in the natural realm. And it may be evil or it may be good. Now, do you see, Jesus didn't take that attitude. Jesus didn't say, sickness is an option for Christians. He implied that sickness was part of the work of the devil. And that he came, you remember in 1 John it says, Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. And I think it's old Paul talking about Jesus in Acts 10 and 38 points that out, that Jesus regarded both sin and sickness as a work of the devil. Acts 10 and 38. It's Peter, Acts 10 and 38. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And Jesus regarded sickness as an oppression or a work of the devil. And so, brothers and sisters, if we ever regard sickness as just a natural thing in our lives, do you see, we're treating a work of the devil as something natural, and that's what he wants. He wants us to treat his works as something natural, something that we ought to expect in the everyday world. And once he can deceive us into that, then half the battle is won as far as he is concerned. But you can see Jesus doesn't think of it that way at all. He thinks of sin as an enemy of his Father and sickness as an enemy of his Father, and he opposes both. Now, maybe it would be good a little to see how to use sickness and the meaning of sickness. Could God ever use sickness to chastise us? And we say staunchly, never! Never. And don't we? You know we do it. We react against that old puritanical, old-fashioned belief that anyone who was sick was a sinner. And so we have reacted away to the other extreme. And we say, no, God never uses sickness to chastise us. But what then is the place of sickness in a believer? Now, it might be good to see why we reacted in that way. It's because of that, John 9 and verse 3, you remember. You remember the man who was born blind. And this is the basis of our attitude to sickness, whereby we say, no, God would never use sickness to chastise his children. John 9 and verse 3. You remember verse 2, his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And verse 3, Jesus answered, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be made manifest in him. And we then tend to say, there it is in black and white. Sin never causes sickness. That's what Jesus is saying. This man didn't sin, nor his parents sinned. Sickness has nothing to do with sin, and God therefore could never use sickness to chastise his children. Now do you see, first of all, that this sickness is utterly different from that we're talking about in believers. This sickness was something that the man was born with. So it was of a different nature entirely to the sicknesses that come upon God's children. It was a different sickness. It was one that the man was born with. It was a different situation. Secondly, do you see that Jesus isn't saying, no, sickness is never due to sin. He's just saying, in this case, it wasn't this man that sinned, nor was it his parents that sinned. And Jesus is really saying, every time you see a sick person, don't immediately say that they have sinned. But you see, that's a far cry from saying sickness is never due to sin. Now, brothers and sisters, do you see the two extremes? Jesus is saying, look, every time you see a sick person, don't immediately say, like these disciples, this man has sinned or his parents have sinned. Jesus is saying, that's not always the case. There are many people who are sick who haven't sinned and brought their sickness upon themselves. But that's a far cry from Jesus saying, no, my Father never uses sickness to draw attention to any sin in your life. Now, do you see, it's important for us to balance out, loved ones. It's important for us to accept what Jesus says. Every time you see a sick person, you can't say, you've sinned greatly because you have a great sickness. But on the other hand, you shouldn't run to the other extreme and say, no, God never uses sickness to chastise his children. In fact, there are some indications in the Bible that God can use what is really a work of Satan. You see, God never sends sickness. God doesn't send sickness and then send his son to die for sickness. See, that doesn't make sense. You can't have A and non-A. You can't have God opposing sickness and then sending sickness. You can't have him sending sickness upon the earth and then sending his son to take away sickness. But God can use a work of Satan, and he can use it for his own purposes. Now, let's look at just some of the verses that would help us with that. 1 Corinthians 10 and verses 30 through 32. 1 Corinthians 10 and verses 30 through 32. I'm not doing so well. I think I'm looking for 7, maybe. And brothers and sisters, it's the chapter that deals with the communion and with the Lord's Supper. So if you just give me a number, I think I can... 11. 1 Corinthians 11 and verses 30 through 32. Thanks, John. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we should not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are chastened, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. Now, brothers and sisters, do you see in verse 30 that that can mean not only spiritual death, when you drink the body and blood of Jesus without discerning or without judging yourself, you see, and examining yourself about your sins. But it can mean really what it says. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we should not be judged. In other words, if you examined yourself, Paul says, you should not have to be judged by God or brought to account by him. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are chastened. And of course, the obvious implication of that verse with the previous one is, when we are chastened by sickness, then we are judged, we are chastened, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. It is for a good purpose. Now, that's one of the verses that suggests it. Now, let's look at another, James 5 and verse 16. James 5 and verse 16. And it makes sense of this verse, you see, which perhaps many of us have often wondered why the two facts are mentioned in this verse, James 5 and 16. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Now, do you see that God connects confession of sins with praying that you may be healed? And you see the previous verse has the same emphasis, verse 15, and the prayer of faith will save the sick man, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. And closely, the two are connected, the confession of sins and the healing of sickness. Do you see that the normal state of God's children is the normal state of the Israelites? Now, that's the state described in Exodus 15 and 26. Exodus 15 and 26. Exodus 15 and 26. God saying, if you will diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord your God, and do that which is right in his eyes, and give heed to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases upon you which I put upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord your healer. Now that's the normal state of the children of God. That God puts, or allows Satan to put, none of the diseases upon us that ordinary non-Christians experience, if we will abide by his statutes. But do you see that when the Father sees us needing chastening, then he is able to use a work of Satan to bring us to a place of self-examination. Now, what is very important, you know, for us to see is that it is not just connected with ordinary sin. That's important. Otherwise, if we teach that it's always connected with sin, anybody with a cold tonight is in a bad shape, and you'd better just keep your coughs quiet, you know. Otherwise, everybody will look at you and say, ha-ha, you're sinning like mad again. So, it's very important to see that it isn't chastening, is not simply connected with sin, you see. It is connected with the growth in Christ-likeness, you see. God chastens his children whom he loves. Now, maybe it would be good to settle that one from Jesus' own words. It's in Luke 13 and verse 2. When we talk about God using sickness to chasten his children, we're not talking only about sin. We may be talking about sin, but not necessarily about sin. You can be talking about a new position of Christ-likeness into which God is trying to bring his children. Luke 13 and verse 2. And he answered them, do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered thus? So again, it's Jesus' balance, you see. It's Jesus saying, no, every time you see somebody who's sick, don't say, ah, they must have sinned. Because God is concerned not only with bringing us into an awareness of sin in our lives, but with bringing us into new positions of Christ-likeness. You see, Job is an example of that. If you look at Job chapter 1 and verses 7 through 12, you'll find that Job was not regarded really as in any way a great sinner by God. And it's Job chapter 1 and verses 7 through 12. And it's 434, if you have the same trouble I have, finding Job. Job chapter 1 and verses 7 through 12. The Lord said to Satan, whence have you come? Satan answered the Lord, from going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it. And the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil? Now, that's God saying that, you see. So obviously Noah was a blameless and upright man as far as God was concerned. Then Satan answered the Lord, "Does Job fear God for naught? Hast thou not put a hedge round about him and his house and all that he has on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But put forth thy hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse thee to thy face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, all that he has is in your power. Only upon himself do not put forth your hand." That is, don't destroy him physically. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. And you remember God allowed Satan to bring all kinds of sicknesses and boils and pains and sufferings to Job. And so God will use sickness sent by Satan, first of all, to bring us into an awareness of some sin that there may be in our lives. And secondly, to bring us into a new place of Christ-likeness. Now, do you see that this affects our whole attitude to sickness when it comes? Our response to sickness. Do you see that we shouldn't scurry around looking for a cure? And that's our attitude, isn't it? We say, sickness is of Satan, so once it comes about, we must get a cure. We must get a cure, either by a doctor, by medicine, by drugs, or by a healer, anything. But we must get a cure. We must get rid of the sickness. Now, brothers and sisters, do you see that that isn't the attitude of children of God who trust their Father? The attitude of children of God is, "Father, you said you would put none of these sicknesses upon me. Now, is there any way in which I have become self-reliant in your work? Or in which I have become greedy in your work? Or is there any sin that is lodging in my life that you are trying to bring before my mind? Because I know, Father, once I confess that and turn from it, I know I won't have to try to whip myself into a frenzy to believe that you're healing. I know the healing life will flow from Jesus and will fill me and heal me and make me whole." And loved ones, that is to be our attitude to sickness. There shouldn't be this panic, you see, and this terrible fear. We must get rid of it at all costs. But there should be the attitude of children who have a loving, dear Father. And we should go to him and say, "Now, Father, it's your own word in Exodus that you'll put none of these diseases upon me. Now, I can only believe that you're using this sickness that Satan has brought to bring something before my mind. Now, Father, is there any sin in me that is there?" And loved ones, do you see, you don't burrow into yourself in introspection. You ask the Father, you listen to the Holy Spirit, and if he brings a sin before you, you repent, you confess it. You make the thing right with somebody else if the sin has been against somebody else, or if it's against God, you make it right with him. And then you look to the Father and you say, "Father, I will receive healing just as you want me to receive it now. I know it is here. I know it is my position." Now, if there's nothing, then you go before the Holy Spirit and you ask, "Holy Spirit, is there any new place you want me to come in here? Is there any new place, new position in Jesus that you want me to enter into?" Loved ones, I honestly think that we don't realize how much Jesus wants us to draw into an experience of his own sufferings. I think we really feel it's a superficial, easy thing to become like Jesus. No, it isn't, loved ones. If Jesus had to learn obedience through suffering, do you see that we are called into the same thing? You know, we like to think that once we've reckoned ourselves dead with Christ, then that's the end of it. But do you see that God only requires of us permission at that point to begin to bring us into something of Jesus' sufferings? Do you see that there is a self-love? There are self-desires. There is a self-will in us that has to be burned out. It cannot be thought out or prayed out. It has to be burned out and at times suffered out. And after we've entered into a willingness to be crucified with Jesus, then we have the glory of walking the Calvary Road with Jesus. And I think I shared with you before that I used to think all Jesus was asking me to do was, would I be willing to be nothing? Would I be willing to be a failure? Would I be willing not to have my own desires? And then as the years passed, I found that he did the dirty on me. He began to ask me actually to walk into these things. And you know, he tested the old will inside and really was saying, would you really be willing? Would you really be willing? Is this bit of you dead? Is this bit of you dead? Is this bit of you dead? And he'd stick needles in, you know, to see if that bit was dead. And that's the Father, you see. That really you can only come into a real Christ-likeness if you're willing to take part in Jesus' own suffering. Now, you find that, you know, because I know it's a hard teaching. You find that there, it's Philippians 3 and verse 10. You remember Paul mentions it. Philippians 3 and verse 10. That I may, Philippians 3 and 10, yeah. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. And that's pretty explicit, you see. That Paul says, there is a sense in which we are to share Jesus' sufferings and become like him in his death. And it's only in his death that we can become like him. And so God will often use sickness to bring us into a place with Jesus that is close to his heart. So God uses sickness at times to point out actual positive sin in our lives. At other times, he uses sickness to try to bring us into a new place with himself. A new position in Jesus. And of course, the reason is this, so that we will produce work that is lasting. You see, if you are in the same place as Jesus, the work that God does through you will be lasting. Now, do you remember that Paul makes a distinction between two kinds of work? Maybe it's good to look at it in 1 Corinthians 3 and 12 and 13. 1 Corinthians 3. And 12 and 13. Paul, you remember, talks about the foundation of Jesus. And then about the building that men put upon it. And the building would be things like the body here, you see, that we're building, or fish enterprises, or a work that God does through you in the world, or through all of us. Now in verse 12, now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, I say, either precious stones or silver or wood, hay, stubble, each man's work will become manifest, for the day, that is the day of judgment, will disclose it, because it will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. And superficial, shallow work that has been done by shallow little Christians who have entered into none of the fellowship of Jesus' sufferings, that work will be wood, hay, and stubble and will not last. And so it's vital for us to be willing to regard our sicknesses as a possible way that God has in bringing us close to himself. Never that sickness is his final will for us, you see. God's ideal will for us is perfect health. But it is his permissive will, as it was his permissive will to use suffering with Jesus, it is his permissive will to bring us into an awareness of a new place with himself. Now, I just share with you, you know, a book that I've just started to read, and I suppose should have read a long time ago, a book the same as Calvary Road by Brian Hessian, remember. And the Calvary Road book deals with the life of fellowship with Jesus' sufferings after the crisis experience of being filled with the Spirit. And you can see that there are a lot of naive people running around filled with the Spirit. And hallelujah and amen, we're filled with the Spirit. But bless their hearts, you know, they have turned from any of the fellowship of Jesus' suffering. You know, anything that is suffering in any way or travail, they have turned from it and said, no, no, that must be wrong, that must be wrong. It must be just hallelujah, amen all the time. Well, it is. But it's often a deep hallelujah and a deep amen from the heart of a spirit that has come onto the cross with Jesus in a new way. And this is partly what this book talks about, hinds feet on high places. Hinds, H-I-N-D, apostrophe S, hinds feet. And God talks, you know, about how we will skip on the mountains, on the high places, like hinds, light and easily and agilely. And of course, this woman is talking about how a person comes to those high places. And she has an allegorical conversation, you see, between this person and her Lord. And I'll just read really a little of the preface. This is her preface. But the high places of victory and union with Christ cannot be reached by any mental reckoning of self to be dead to sin, or by seeking to devise some way or discipline by which the will can be crucified. The only way is by learning to accept day by day the actual conditions and tests permitted by God, by a continually repeated laying down of our own will and acceptance of His, as it is presented to us in the form of the people with whom we have to live and work and in the things which happen to us. Every acceptance of His will becomes an altar of sacrifice. And then, you know, she has the actual conversation on, I think it's 41, if you buy the book yourself. The servant says to Jesus, Jesus introduces her to the two helpers who will bring her onto the high places, into the victorious life. And she looks at them in horror. He's told her their names. And she says, I can't go with them. I can't. Oh, my Lord Shepherd, why do you do this to me? How can I travel in their company? It is more than I can bear. You tell me that the mountain way itself is so steep and difficult that I cannot climb it alone. Then why must you make sorrow and suffering my companions? And those were the two companions that Jesus introduced her to, sorrow and suffering. Couldn't you have given joy and peace to go with me, to strengthen me and encourage me and help me in the difficult way? I never thought you would do this to me. And she burst into tears. A strange look passed over the shepherd's face as he listened to this outburst. Then, looking at the veiled figures as he spoke, he answered very gently, Joy and peace? Are those the companions you would choose for yourself? You remember your promise to accept the helpers that I would give because you believed that I would choose the very best possible guides for you? Will you still trust me, much afraid? That was the name she was given, much afraid. Will you go with them, or do you wish to turn back to the valley and to all your fearing relatives, to Craven Fear himself? Now, loved ones, do you see that it brings a new meaning into sickness? If we can see that it's not a matter of scurrying away to the nearest faith healer or scurrying away to the first doctor, but rather a going to our Father first and saying, Lord, why has this come upon me? I know you can keep this from me. Why have you allowed it to come upon me? What do you want me to repent of? Or what new position into Jesus do you want me to enter? And you see, it's this way that God begins to expose any self that is still there. Loved ones, we will say in the glory of health, Father, I will take from your hand whatever you choose to give me. But in the midst of sickness, God can tell whether we meant that or not. We will say in the glory of health, Lord, I don't care what happens to me, I will look to you alone. But when sickness comes and we get wrapped up in the symptoms, and we begin to wonder, are we hot enough? Or are we too cold? Or are those people giving me the right sympathy? Or are they treating me right? Am I looking after myself right? As we get involved more and more in the symptoms of our sickness, we see that God is using that sickness to expose the self that we thought was absolutely on the cross. And do you see that what God wants in the midst of sickness is a forgetfulness of the sickness? That's it. That proves to him that we're where he wants us to be. Where we forget the sickness, we say, Father, I thank you for allowing this to come upon me. I know it's here for some reason. Now, will you reveal to me whether it's positive sin in me or whether it's a new place of completeness in Jesus that you want me to enter into? And then, you see, he wants us to be content to have the sickness as long as he wants us to have it. Because the truth is, loved ones, once the cause, once the reason for the sickness is removed, the sickness will be healed. The sickness will be healed once the reason is dealt with. But do you see that if we get down under it and we start yielding to Satan and saying, oh, I'm a sinner, I'm a sinner, something must be wrong, and we don't look to the loving healer himself, then, of course, the sickness will work death in us. Now, loved ones, I think that's maybe as far as we should go tonight, just in really God's attitude to sickness and our attitude, and then how God can use sickness.